Hello and welcome to the Clinical Society meeting. Today the first presentation is from Unit B, Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. The moderator for the first session is Professor Sangeeta Rai. Over to Professor Sangeeta Rai.
Good morning, respected director sir, all my senior teachers, dear colleagues and juniors. Today we are going to present an unusual case of secondary amenorrhea with a diagnostic dilemmas. I request Dr. Kirti to start her presentation.
Good morning, respected teachers, seniors, and my dear junior. I, Dr. Kirti from Unit B, Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, will be presenting a case of secondary amenorrhea. My patient is Mrs. X. She is 23-year female, primary gravida, married for 2 years, belonging to middle socioeconomic status, presented to us in December 2020 with the chief complaint of amenorrhea for 8 months. According to the patient, when she was amenorrheic for 1 month, she did her urinary pregnancy test at her home in May 2020, which was positive, and she considered herself pregnant. As there was COVID pandemic ongoing, so she did not visit any hospital for her routine antenatal checkup. She had nausea and vomiting in initial 2 months of amenorrhea, which subsided spontaneously like in normal pregnancy. She neither had enlargement of abdomen or perceived any fetal movement with increasing period of amenorrhea. She never experienced any abdominal pain, vaginal spotting, or irregular bleeding during this period of amenorrhea. As she was not experiencing any pregnancy-related changes in herself, then she visited a district hospital in December 2020 after 8 months, where she was diagnosed to have a hydatidiform mole, for which she was referred to our hospital. Upon taking her menstrual history, she attained menarche at 14 years of age. She had a previous cycle of regular flow with average flow of 4 to 5 days at an interval of 28 to 32 days. Her last menstrual period was 23rd of April 2020, which gives her an ADD of 30th January 2021. There was no history of tuberculosis, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, hypothyroidism. There was no history of cough, fever, or breathlessness. She was vegetarian with a normal sleep pattern. Her bowel and bladder habits were normal. There was no any history of addiction. Her family history was not contributory to her present illness. At the time of examination, she was conscious, cooperative, well-oriented to time, place, and person. She had average build and a BMI of 22.2 kg per meter square. She was afebrile with a pulse of 80 per minute, blood pressure of 110 by 84 mm of Hg, and respiratory rate was 18 per minute. There was no pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, generalized lymphadenopathy, or pedal edema. Her JVP was not raised. Her higher mental function was normal. On chest auscultation, there were bilateral equal air entry without any added sound. S1, S2 were normally heard. On per abdomen inspection, it was flat with a centrally placed umbilicus. There was no distension, no visible peristalsis, pulsation, venous engorgement, or pigmentation. All quadrants were moving with respiration. On palpation, the abdomen was soft, non-tender, no organomegaly or lump palpable. Uterus was also not palpable per abdominally. On peri-speculum examination, the vagina and cervix were normal. Cervical loss was nulliparous. There was no bleeding or discharge. On pervaginal examination, uterus was corresponding to 12-week size. It was antiverted mobile site to site with a bilateral free fornices and non-tender. Her routine investigation was done, which were normal. As she was having a period of amenorrhea with positive urinary pregnancy test, we did her serum beta-HCG, which came out to be 1467 milli international unit per ml, which is considered as elevated. Her chest X-ray was within normal limit and COVID RT-PCR was negative. Her TVS pelvis was done, which showed that uterus was enlarged with a heterogeneous mass echogenic lesion in the posterior endomyometrial body and the fundus of the uterus without transserosal extension. You can see here, this is a uterus and this is a posterior wall in the fundus. There is an echogenic lesion inside the endomyometrial part of the body and the fundus. On applying Doppler, there was an increased peripheral vascularity in around the lesion, and the findings of ultrasound were suggestive of molar pregnancy. So, as with the clinical history of amenorrhea with elevated beta HCG and a molar changes in on ultrasound, our first differential diagnosis was partial molar pregnancy, second was missed abortion, and third was placental site trophoblastic tumor. So after that, we planned her for hysteroscopy, and hysteroscopy was done with the proper consent. We were surprised to see that there was no any molar changes inside the uterus, but there was a dried sac-like structure which was hanging from the posterior wall of the uterus. Here you can see that there is a white dried sac-like structure which is hanging from the posterior wall of the uterus. This is a sac and whole of the endometrium.
Just I want to interrupt you in the differential diagnosis which you have kept. What were the points favoring and against?
Yes, sir. Sir, I have discussed it in.
Let me complete.
Yes, sir.
You can discuss here also. I think before proceeding to the investigation part, you can discuss the differential diagnosis.
The next slide is regarding that only, what you have asked.
Okay.
Sir, on the basis of clinical findings, she was having amenorrhea and her urinary pregnancy test was positive, but the diagnosis of pregnancy was ruled out on the basis of clinical history as well as clinical examination, because she was neither perceiving any fetal movement or there was no distension of abdomen with the increasing period of gestation. And on clinical examination, it was also evident that there was a huge disparity between the size of the uterus and the period of gestation, which ruled out that there was no pregnancy. But when we ordered her a serum beta HCG and the USG showed the molar changes, the diagnosis of molar pregnancy was again, complete molar was again ruled out, because in complete molar pregnancy, the beta HCGs are usually in lacs and they are very symptomatic. Patient present in early trimester with a complaint of bleeding, hyperemesis gravidarum, symptoms of preeclampsia and thyrotoxicosis. And other diagnosis, differential diagnosis was missed abortion, because we can see a cystic changes which can mimic the molar pregnancy in ultrasound, but in missed abortion, the beta HCG are usually negative and there would not be any peripheral vascularity around the lesion, and the missed abortion will not present with amenorrhea for 8 months. So our differential diagnosis first was partial molar pregnancy and second was placental site trophoblastic tumor, because there was a pregnancy like event going on inside the uterus and there was a mildly elevated beta HCG with a period of amenorrhea. So after hysteroscopy, we found that there was a dried sac-like structure inside the uterus, and the whole of the endometrium was thin and pale without any vascularity or vascular lesion, which was again ruling out the differential diagnosis of placental site trophoblastic tumor, and the finding of hysteroscopy were coinciding with the finding of missed abortion. After hysteroscopy, we did a curettage, and this was the product of conceptus which was obtained. And this, you can see here, this is also not showing any classical feature of molar pregnancy. And this conceptus was sent for histopathological examination and cytogenetics. And after procedure, there was minimal bleeding. And on histopathology, it showed that there was a elongated fibrotic villi without central cisternio syncytial trophoblastic proliferation, which were consistent with the finding of missed abortion. There were no definitive molar changes identified on histopathology. This is a microscopic view of histopathology showing elongated fibrotic villi. This is a fibrotic villi and these are the normal villi without any cisternae or trophoblastic proliferation, which is not again supporting our diagnosis of partial molar pregnancy. On cytogenetic analysis of POC, a product of conceptus was done by FISH analysis. The probe for most common aneuploidy chromosome 13, 18, 21 and X was used. You can see here in a blue circle that 13, 21 and 18 chromosome, there were two chromosome per cell, which were normal, but there was only one X chromosome. It was suggesting that there is a monosomy of chromosome X. This is a picture of FISH analysis. The green color probe was used for X chromosome, which is again showing only one, suggesting monosomy X. As the product of conceptus was having an abnormal chromosome, so we ordered the karyotyping of mother as well as father. The patient was having normal chromosome karyotype of 46XX, and her husband was also 46XY, which were normal. So patient was discharged on day two of the procedure, and she was followed with a serial beta HCG level. You can see here that after 1 week, the beta HCG has fallen more than 50%, and after 3 week, it became negative. As the endometrium was thin and pale, we have given her one cycle of estrogen plus progesterone. Now she is having regular menstrual cycle for last 5 months without any medication. This was the ultrasound previous was done after 2 months of the procedure. It is showing a thickened endometrium, which is coinciding with the period of menstrual cycle.
What was the dose of estrogen and progesterone used?
Sir, as she was on hysteroscopy, we have found that the whole of the endometrium was thin and pale. There was no vascularity inside the uterus. So we have given for the regeneration of the endometrium
dose.
And the dose
of estrogen progesterone.
It was 2 mg of Primarin was given, and followed by 7 days of Debri 10 mg.
Okay.
So our case is very atypical because it has presented with a diagnostic dilemma, because there was a disparity between clinical, biochemical, radiological and histopathological finding. I have discussed the differential diagnosis till the hysteroscopy. When the hysteroscopy was available, which was suggesting that there is a missed abortion, the diagnosis of placental cytotrophoblastic tumor was put aside, and on histopathology and cytogenetics, it was proven that it was a missed abortion due to monosomy X, and it was also ruling out our diagnosis of partial molar pregnancy. So our provisional diagnosis is missed abortion due to monosomy X, but still there is a query, because missed abortion do not present with a long period of amenorrhea, and why there was a positive beta HCG for this 8 months, and why there was increased peripheral vascularity in the myometrium also. As we all know that Turner syndrome is a most common sex chromosome abnormality in the female fetus. There may be partial or complete absence of second X chromosome with or without mosaicism. The incidence varies from 1 in 1500 to 2500 live born infant. The frequency of 45X at conception is at approximately 3%, but 99% of them are aborted spontaneously in the first trimester. This is a picture showing a typical phenotypic feature of the Turner syndrome. Mosaic genotypic are present in approximately half of the cases of Turner syndrome. They can present with a vast variety of presentation. They can present with apparent phenotypic changes or can present with early fetal lethality. A conceptus with a Turner survives to term only when there is coexistence of normal cell line is also present. Thus, chromosome mosaicism explains why aneuploid survived to term. So our final diagnosis is a missed abortion with monosomy X, which was mimicking persistent trophoblastic tumor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kirti. Yes, actually, we all are clinicians, and we are always dealing with some of the cases which are very much normal, which we study, which we found in the radiological diagnosis and histopathology. But in this case, it was a dilemma from the starting. There was a disparity in the clinical, the biochemical, the radiological, and the histopathological. But yes, we have to follow this case because still there is doubt of molar pregnancy, especially partial molar pregnancy, we are keeping in the mind because the missed abortion always will not be present typically like this also, as Dr. Kirti has said. Because still we have done the ultrasound of these patients after 2 months of curettage, we can see some cystic changes are there, some, very few. Yes, but the myometrial changes has resolved. So this alarms us that yes, it may be a case of unusual persistent trophoblastic disease, maybe a molar pregnancy, yet the beta hCG becomes normal. So we have to do the beta hCG because there may be again a rise of beta hCG. We should keep in mind that in case of partial molar pregnancy, there is less than 1% chance of distant and 1 to 4% chance of local invasion. So we have to follow the patient. Yes, we have some limitations because in PSCT, we are not able to do the immunohistochemistry by HPL. And also in to differentiate between the complete molar pregnancy and the partial molar pregnancy, we can do the P57. That is a marker which is mainly common in cases of partial molar pregnancy, not in the complete molar pregnancy. So these are some of the limitations we have faced. But yes, it is a very unusual case and we are still following the patient, but the patient doesn't have any symptoms. She is very happy. In fact, she's not coming to us. That why you are calling us? Why you are bothering us? I have normal menstrual cycle. But yes, this type of unusual presentations, we have to keep in mind. And yes, we have to follow up. Regarding the Turner syndrome, it is very rarely found in only less than 10% of the cases that most of the partial molar present with a karyotype of triploid. But some of the partial molar may present with tetraploid or mosaic exo pattern. So in our case, we have found that. So this may be a missed abortion with a consistent finding of the placental exaggeration, or there may be a partial molar with this atypical pattern or presentation of the chromosomal abnormality. So thank you so much. Please, I am ready for all the queries.
Thank you, ma'am. You completed your presentation in time. That's wonderful. One remark from audience also that we should not disclose the identity of the patient. In the reports, the identity of the patient was disclosed. So that's that part needs to be removed.
Thank you.
The question from Professor Sanjeev Gupta, sir, that is, what is the risk? How we are going to have follow up for the future pregnancies?
Well, actually, this is a case of basically still we are in doubt. So we have to follow this patient till at least 3 months with the beta hCG level, whether it is rising or it has become low and will be persisting in the lower side. If this is persisting in the normal side for the next 3 months, we will tell the patient that yes, she can go for further conception, and yes, this pregnancy might be a risk. So we have to do all the biochemical and the genetic evaluation in the next pregnancy. That is important.
And how
Abhishek, I have got one more question.
Yes, sir, please.
Dr. Sangeeta, you mentioned three things. One is partial molar pregnancy. Second is complete molar pregnancy, and third is hydatidy form mole. So how do you, what is the difference between these three?
Sir, complete mole or H mole, basically they are same. The molar pregnancy and partial molar pregnancy, there is a difference because there is a focal trophoblastic neoplasia in case of molar pregnancy, that is complete, and there is in case of molar pregnancy, there's a generalized trophoblastic neoplasia with the hydropic degenerations. So there's no fetal tissue in case of molar pregnancy. But in the partial molar pregnancy, we can get a fetal tissue. That is the difference. And yes, the ultrasound features may be confusing. If Dr. Ashish Sharma sir is there, we can welcome him so that he can comment on the radiological confusion and the query about that molar or partial molar presentation. But yes, the cystic changes that are there, they basically tells us that there may be a component of molar. Okay, but sir, the problem is that we cannot do here the T57 gene study, that is immunohistochemistry, because some limitations, and that can differentiate between the molar and the partial molar pregnancy, complete and partial molar. So these are some limitations, sir, but yes, I think in coming years we will be able to do all these things, and our research will be much more better, and we can improve our knowledge.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I request Professor N.K. Agarwal, sir, please unmute yourself and give your comments.
Thank you, Dr. Abhishek, and good morning to all. Regarding the Turner syndrome, as it was said that only the mosaics survive, that is not the case. The Turner's XOV find so many patients. So we do encounter living XO. So only mosaics survive, that is not the case. And there are mosaics, and we can find it by fish. So the pregnancies with Turner do not survive largely, but those who survive, they can have various problems. So that is a possibilities are there, that the such patients are living.
Sir, literature has shown that the mosaic will have more chance for survival, because if there is a component of normal chromosome and the abnormal chromosome, the chances of viability is much more increased. Okay, but in case of pure Turner syndrome, the chances of non-viability is there. So that fetus is resorbed because of the pure Turner syndrome. But in case of, we are getting our Turner's females, when we do the fish analysis, we can get some normal cells, and that is present in the literature. Okay, so complete Turner syndrome, very, very rare we found that they go beyond the period of viability.
Yeah, but once we do get clinical cases, we have those which are not mosaics. So they are short, very short Turners. So we get in our OPDs.
Sir, they are very, very rare presentations. And if you do the chromosomal analysis of all the cells, we can find some mosaicism, some normal cells along with the mosaicism. So this is the literature research we have done, and we are presenting like that only.
Like in this patient, there was this doubt about whether the patient was actually true XO, or what you said, monosomy XO or not. Or there was, you also mentioned it could be triple XO. So, okay.
Yes.
So,
could, but it was not triple. It was only XO only, sir. And they have studied in 40% of the cells.
Right.
So, the problem with the abnormal chromosomal karyotype is much more there, and this leads to the resorption of that fetus.
Right. So my actually query is whether we could have done the bar body. Bar body is a very simple test. We could have done it in our lab also, because in XO chromosomal constitution, we should not get any bar bodies, isn't it? But yes, if it is a 3XO variety, we should get two bar bodies like that. So bar body is actually a very simple histological procedure. Our own lab could do that easily. So would that have been helpful in this particular patient,
sir,
just to prove that
for the this is not helpful in this case, because we can see that product of conception, it was very old, okay, and the minimal tissue what we get, they have done the analysis and come out with this result. Bar body we can do if the patient we are suspecting is a mosaicism or Turner syndrome after the birth of the baby, and there we can do the analysis. But in this conceptus is very difficulty to differentiate between maternal tissue and the fetal tissue. It's very difficult. Even we have talked to the genetic persons, they have told us that we don't have that techniques or mechanism, their cost is very high. So if you can separate us the fetal tissue and the maternal tissue, then we can make the diagnosis much more nicely. But in these cases, which are old conceptus resolved, that is very difficult for us to visualize within the fetal tissue, as I have shown in the histopathology what we have done.
Abhishek, can I comment?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible or not?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Very rightly said, but what you are saying, the correct thing is that the most of the miscarriage, if you analyze the karyotype, in most of the miscarriage, you will find Turner syndrome. So Turner syndrome, fetus loss is around 99%. Only 1% survive.
Yes.
But 1% is also contributing. 1% means it is 1 out of 2,500 birth. That is why we are seeing classical Turner syndrome in clinics. And they do survive normally also.
Yes.
Because because they have the deficiencies, but they survive. They have short stature, they don't have reproductive things, but they still survive. They have most of the functions or functioning organ. Mosaic have higher chance of survival, and therefore the mosaic pattern in aborted tissues will be less, but classical XO will be more in the aborted tissues. So you have rightly done this analysis. Actually, it is not very much required to do analysis karyotype in miscarriages, because you are not going to help anyway, except that you might counsel the patients that there would be a risk of Turner pregnancy.
Yes,
again,
because these are always sporadic in nature.
Yeah, that is the only thing, but again, it will not be very cost effective. Yes. Buccal, the bar body is done with the buccal smear, and that is in the living body only. That cannot be done in the fetus and all this. So this is what I want to comment. But as you said, that there is a fetal tissue left, and that can happen with any miscarriage, and that will also be true for Turner syndrome. So it is not related to Turner syndrome that there was unleft tissue and that has created problem. Thank you, sir.
Professor Madhukar Raya, sir, please.
Precisely, Professor S.K. Singh has said what I wanted to say, that it's not a viability which is all the patient of Turner syndrome will be lost. Had it been so, you would have never seen a patient of Turner syndrome. And they present with various degree of variant dysplasias. That's a different story depending upon the degree of mosaic. Even some of the Turner can go on to become pregnant because of there is no complete gonadal dysgenesis, right? So Turner syndrome can, and we see a lot of patients, it means that all patients, they do survive.
That
and
is part,
very, very predictive test. Now we should not mention about bar bodies, because these were the days when we did not have access to chromosomal analysis and other thing. Now the cytogenetics and molecular studies have evolved so much that we are looking for a particular gene rather than a whole chromosome loss also. So that is practically, so this is what was my comment, that probably the fetal loss was due to Turner, but increased beta HCG was due to different phenomena, which was surviving, a little bit of the central tissue was there, which was secreting.
Yes, sir. But this is a persistent increase.
So I was thinking more about this type of missed abortion rather than Turner syndrome, because Turner syndrome is one of the causes.
Yes.
Of many causes which can lead to an abortion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Can I add something, Dr. Abhishek?
Yes, yes.
First thing, the question that we do not see the non-mosaic Turner, that is not the case. We in the pediatrics see the non-mosaic Turners, and their percentage could be low. And second thing, I still do not agree with that you should not go for karyotype, the tissue karyotype of the tissue, because there are increased chances of recurrence in the future pregnancy. If there may be, you may not find Turner, you may find other trisomies, like trisomy 21 could be a cause of this missed abortion, or this, or there could be translocations which could lead to recurrent loss of pregnancy. So there are still role of karyotyping in the fetal tissue and the parents. So they were correct in doing the karyotyping of this fetal tissue. So this point I have to make.
Thank you, sir. So this question for the resident who presented the case. Was there any risk factor present for this molar pregnancy?
No, sir. As she was primary, there was no any history of any abortion or any miscarriages in previous. As she was primary, and it was a 22 years old, there was no any risk factor which was suggesting a molar pregnancy also. But we found a sporadic XO Turner's monosomy, which can occur to anyone, and there is rare chances of recurrence in the future pregnancy. We will follow her as a normal pregnancy if she conceives, and we will do ultrasound with the USG, NT scan and dual marker at the 11 and 13 weeks, 11 to 13 weeks of gestations.
I request Honorable Director to give his comments.
Thank you, Abhishek. So it's a well presented case and good discussion thereof. Yes. All the questions they have clearly answered, like future pregnancy also, they how to manage, but what is the advice for future pregnancy? Though management they have told how they will follow up the patient.
Yes.
But any advice whether they should, patient should go for pregnancy or not in the future?
Yes, they can, sir, they can go for a spontaneous conception, but yes, after I already told you that, sir, for 3 months we have to follow her with the beta HCG level, and if it is normal, then we can advise her, and in the next pregnancy we will do all the markers and the NT scan and then follow up that pregnancy very closely. That is more important, because we know that these cases of Turner's, they are very much sporadic. They cannot recur in every pregnancy. But yes, we should be alert and follow up these patients.
Yeah, that's more important, to be alert.
Yes.
Thank
yes.
you. Well presented and good.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Abhishek.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. So moving to the second presentation, it's from Team B, Department of Orthopedics. And the moderator is Professor Amit Rastogi, sir. So over to Professor Amit Rastogi, sir.
Good morning, Director sir, my seniors, colleagues and my dear friends, everybody who has joined. Today we'll be presenting a case of a polytrauma with a slightly rare presentation of an injury which we normally do not see and which we normally would actually tend to miss. The case would also highlight how good coordination can give you better results, and would also highlight where we are deficient in our management. So I'd request Dr. Rahul Patel to start with his presentation.
Good morning, sir. So am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Audible. Good morning. Good morning, respected teachers, my seniors, my colleagues. Myself, Dr. Rahul Patel. I'm a junior resident, third year, from Unit B, Department of Orthopedics. Today, I'm going to present a case of novel presentation of occult injury in polytrauma patient and its management in limited resources. My patient, Pramod, name is changed. A 38-year-old male patient presented on 14th of November 2016 after a road traffic accident with chief complaints of pain and swelling over right leg near knee joint with head injury and injury to the right eye. Patient was a businessman by occupation and a resident of Ghazipur, Uttar Pradesh. Patient was attended and managed according to the trauma protocol. Patient was resuscitated first and provisionally diagnosed with a proximal tibia fracture, for which he was primarily managed with skeletal traction. Patient was also diagnosed as a frontal contusion, for which he was admitted under neurosurgery department, and there he was managed conservatively. During his stay in the neurosurgery ward, patient started developing pain and swelling in his right eye, for which ophthalmology opinion was taken, and they advised the symptomatic treatment. After taking the treatment, patient improved the symptoms and swelling was also resolved. After 2 weeks of the conservatively management, patient was declared fit and or transferred to the orthopedics from the neurosurgery department, for which we manage the patient. This is the preoperative radiograph of the patient, showing comminuted fracture proximal tibia right side, classified as Schadsker type 6. We also advise the preoperative CT scan for the operative planning. CT scan showing in bilateral bicondylar proximal tibia fracture with metaphyseal and diaphyseal separation. And CT scan also showing posterior dislocation of the medial condyle and posterior comminution of the proximal tibia, for which we planned the open reduction and internal fixation of the medial condyle with 3.5 mm LC-DCP and buttressing of the posterior comminution with posterior buttress plate. We did a minimally invasive fixation of proximal tibia with proximal tibia locking plate.
Rahul, if you just tell the full form of the term, like the acronyms you have used, because we are not aware about hardcore orthopedics.
Sir, we did open reduction and internal fixation of dislocated medial fragment with a 3.5 millimeter limited contact dynamic compression plate and posterior comminution with a posterior buttress plate, and did a proximal tibia locking plate fixation with minimally invasive fixation.
Thank you.
That is
percutaneous osteosynthesis. PO is percutaneous osteosynthesis.
Minimally invasive percutaneous osteosynthesis. These are the immediately post-op X-rays showing a nice reduction and nicely fixed implant, and showing a nicely maintained articular congruity. After the 2 days of the operation, patient started developing acute onset swelling on the both eyes and sudden diminution of the vision, for which we again took ophthalmology reference. So this is the clinical picture of the patient after 2 days of the operation, showing sir bilateral proptosis, bilateral ptosis and chemosis. This is the physical examination done by the ophthalmologist, showing bilateral diminution of the vision, painful ophthalmoplegia by bilateral ptosis and proptosis, more on the right side. Conjunctiva showing bilateral tortuous vein with intense chemosis. Cornea was normal both sides. Pupil was dilated and fixed on the right side and sluggish reactive on the left side. Lens were clear, and on fundal examination, there was disc edema, congested tortuous veins. I would like to request the Dr. Deepak Mishra sir from ophthalmology department kindly provide us the on the basis of the physical examination and clinical picture, what should be the provisional diagnosis.
Am I audible, Rahul?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Since the patient has the history of trauma, and you have shown in the figure that he is having axial proptosis.
Yes, sir.
Is having the dilated blood vessels along with the tortuosity in the vessels of the retinal. So there may be the chances that patient may have corticocavernous fistula or the yes. cavernous sinus thrombosis, or even, although I have known that you have taken care of the infection, but there is also the chances of orbital cellulitis. So these yes. 3-4 are the common differential diagnosis for such a case.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So much for your sir valuable comment. So these were the sir provisional diagnosis made during the physical examination. Sir, we also took neurosurgery reference for the follow up of the frontal contusion and the evaluation of this condition. So both for neurosurgeons and by ophthalmologist, CT angiography and or MRI brain was advised. Sir, after 3 days, both the references were reviewed with the CT angiography report. And sir, I would also like to request Dr. Ashish Verma, sir. Sir, kindly, please, sir, give your opinion regarding the positive finding of this CT scan. Dr. Ashish Verma, sir. Or any other respected faculty from the Department of Radiodiagnosis. Sir, in the CT angiography, sir, there were bilateral dilation of the superior ophthalmic vein, and with right-sided carotid cavernous fistula was diagnosed. Dilation of the superior ophthalmic vein more prominently on the right side and less on the left side. I would also like to request respected senior faculty members to and enlighten us about the management of this condition, how we should proceed. Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir.
Rahul, in fact, when the diagnosis is made of the corticocavernous fistula,
yes,
or sir. The AV fistula, then most likely its management is based by the done by the interventional radiologist. Whatever the ophthalmologist can do, we have to prevent for the exposure keratopathy. If since there is a proptosis, so chances of exposure keratopathy, so whatever the local antibiotic ointments or the patching is advised, as I think you have already put in the figure, the patient of the right eye is showing some ointment in his right eye. So yes, the sir. Treatment for the exposure keratopathy will be given to such patient. And for the basically to treat the cause, it is not only the exposure keratopathy, whatever the findings you are getting, proptosis or chemosis, whatever, that is because of the AV fistula. So the main treatment is based on the involvement of the interventional radiologist, which can do the their part and the closure of the fistula by the, them.
I think Ashish Sharma sir has joined. Sir, please give your comment.
Thank you, Dr. Rastogi sir. So, keratoconus cavernous fistula, I think, is one of the entities which is difficult to treat as far as the interventional radiology aspect is concerned. And as is very obvious that the fistula is formed and has to be closed. So in this, we usually take both the arterial as well as the venous aspect because the flow is very active. So we have to ensure that our whatever device or whatever hardware we use to embolize the fistula does not flow in either of the directions. And typically what is used is a balloon, inflatable balloons are available, which are inserted into the fistula, into the cavernous sinus. Usually we start from the cavernous sinus aspect and we inflate the balloon over there. Now these are detachable balloons. So these balloons are usually connected to the end of a long wire or wire, which is and is delivered through a microcatheter. So once the balloon is in place and it is inflated, we detach the balloon by external electronic device, and the balloon essentially blocks the flow. So I think technically means theoretically it's a simple procedure, but technically it is one of the difficult things to treat. Because we know that the cavernous sinus has got multiple communications through the with the pterygoid plexus of vein. So we have to ensure that the alternative path for facial drainage, parapharyngeal and infratemporal drainage does not get occluded. And in addition to these balloons, we also sometimes have to inject glue and coils because there are multiple small feeders which is still. So after we do the first step, which is the balloon embolization of the cavernous sinus, and its principal feeder, we have to do angiograms, and this treatment runs over a period. Usually it runs over a period of 2 to 3 months because these keep opening and have to be sequentially embolized. So it's an interesting entity to treat, but very challenging also as far as the IR aspect is concerned. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we actually inform the patient about the condition, and we inform the patient about its prognosis also. Patient wish to go to the AIIMS New Delhi for the further management of the this condition, for which we communicated with the neurosurgery department of AIIMS New Delhi and also facilitated his transfer. In the AIIMS New Delhi, patient presented with bilateral proptosis, ptosis, bilateral chemosis, and severe loss of vision and tinnitus on the right side with associated with headache. He was diagnosed there carotid cavernous fistula, for which he took treatment. Treatment was embolization of the fistula with a detachable size 5 gold ball balloon done by a collaborative team of neurosurgeons and interventional radiologists. Post embolization, patient reported improvement of the tinnitus, but sir, a balloon was deflated and displaced posteriorly in venous side in the same evening. Four surgeons got the checked angiogram and revised the procedure with size 3 gold ball balloon. After the revision of the procedure, proptosis was also reduced. During the course of the treatment, we were in contact with the patient. We called the patient for follow-up after 2 months. When the patient came to the trauma center OPD, we did a general examination of the patient. There was no sign of any infection of the surgical sites. Patient was doing his physiotherapy in AIIMS New Delhi itself. There was very good range of motion when the patient presented to us. Patient also had fully restoration of vision on the left side at eye and some improvement on the right side. We advised the patient, after checking the x-rays, we advised the patient to walk with a partial weight bearing with the support of walker. carotid cavernous fistula. It's an abnormal communication between previously normal carotid artery and cavernous sinus, characterized as it can be direct or indirect, high flow or low flow. It can be traumatic or spontaneous. Spontaneous substance, conditions like in diabetes mellitus, atherosclerosis, in old age or pregnancy. Treatment most of the time, condition is not life threatening. Only risk of the loss of the vision of the eye is typically there. In few cases, it can be present as intracranial hemorrhage or neurological deterioration. Main indication for the operative treatment are glaucoma, diplopia, severe proptosis causing exposure keratopathy, intolerable bruit, and sometimes it can resolve spontaneously, but most of the time, especially in trauma and high flow type of CCF, thrombosis, closure by thrombosis is unlikely. So treatment is mostly endovascular embolization. 99% of treatment is done by interventional neuroradiologist. Endovascular approach is done. Placement of thrombogenic material such as coils, stents, or balloons. Other treatment like carotid artery ligation, surgical exposure and clipping of the fistula, and packing of cavernous sinus can also be done. So take home message for this presentation is, sir, a multidisciplinary approach, proper references, and timely referral benefited the overall outcome of the patient. We collaborated with the 4 departments and 2 apex institute of the country to manage this patient. Difficult knee fracture to be prioritized, as delay intervention may not be lead to satisfactory output, because intra-articular fracture is an orthopedic emergency, so must be prioritized. High index of suspicion in such cases, dilemma between carotid cavernous fistula, orbital cellulitis, and sympathetic ophthalmitis. Prompt intervention can save the patient's vision. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Rahul. So the case, the title was like, in the resource limited setting, how you manage this patient. So you are able to diagnose the patient, and as per the radiology, the Professor Ashish Verma sir comment that the intervention difficulty, like we have the resources for that. So was any limitation in resources was there? That's why the patient was referred to All India Institute, or the expertise was not there?
This was a case done in 2016. So at that time, I don't think there were much resources here for embolization by an interventional radiologist, number one. Number two, I think there is a problem also with the diagnosis. I think we missed the diagnosis when the patient was in neurosurgery. He did have swelling and proptosis of the eye for 2 days, for which some symptomatic treatment is prescribed. I think at that time, had we had a suspicion that this can be a CCF, then we could have gone in for this thing, and probably we would have been able to save both the eyes. It is good that we could save one eye, but binocular vision is always better than having just one eye. So that I think has to be kept in mind, that we, I think, approached the patient a bit late, and we could have been a bit faster.
I request Professor Vinita Gupta ma'am, please unmute and put your comments.
Thank you, Dr. Abhishek. I was just wondering why presenting a case which is more than 5 years old, that too he was managed in AIIMS. Why not present a case which is more recent and now interventional radiology has taken up in our institute? And that will be more meaningful and more informative rather than a case which is very old and was privately managed in AIIMS. Moreover, it has more of ophthalmic component rather than orthopedics component. So these were my comments.
Yeah, but not really, ma'am. Actually, if you look at the orthopedic portion itself is quite complex. Here, if you do not fix the surgery, this was a very complex surgery orthopedics wise. Of course, it has been upstaged by the ophthalmology portion of the case. But actually, if had the patient not had a ophthalmologic issue, even then, this is a case worth presentation, because this was done by 2 approaches. Normally, we do not use more than 2 plates in fixations of proximal tibia fractures. Here, there was so much comminution and there was so much disturbance of the articular surface of the tibia that we had to use 2 plates through 2 approaches, one of which is fairly complex. So 3 plates. and to approach us. So that was also one of the reasons for presentation. The other was that, of course, we had never seen, I do not know about ophthalmology or radiologists or neurosurgeons, but we had never seen a case of CCF in one of our patients. And that is the reason why we thought this is a good case for presentation.
Dr. Amit?
Yes, sir.
At the end, I noticed there was right side ptosis, complete ptosis on the right side. So was that secondary to the right sided ptosis? Was that secondary to the intervention leading to third nerve injury? Or was it because of the primary injury?
And I don't think it was because of the primary injury, sir. I think Dr. Deepak will be able to tell you a bit better. But the thing is that he had ptosis right from the start. Because of the, when the proptosis reduced, the ptosis became a bit more prominent here. If you also see the presentation, patient also had auditory symptoms. He had tinnitus and he had a headache also. So I think in CCF, there is always a chance that not only the ophthalmologic part, the eye part, the other portions of the brain can also be involved. And that is one reason why this patient is having ptosis.
Because it could point towards third nerve injury also, third nerve dysfunction.
Could be, sir.
Was something done for the ptosis of the right eye? That could be managed, isn't it?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet, okay. But
in fact, it is not necessary also because he does not have much vision in the right eye.
Okay, that's just cosmetic.
Yeah, but the thing is that he started having diminution of vision in both the eyes. And the good part is that we could at least give him one eye back, or rather we could save one eye so that he can walk and he can do some work.
Right, because all these neurosurgical procedures like this thrombosing the fistula and all, they can have some neurological consequences also, undesirable neurological consequences.
Yes,
so I was wondering that whether the third nerve injury was the unintended consequence of the fistula closure. So that's what I was wondering.
Just one quick tip for diagnosis of CCF: put your finger on the proptosis. If it is pulsatile, it is CCF. Otherwise, this could be like we used to do it in case of Graves' ophthalmopathy. We always put a finger on the eyelid, see if there is a pulsation. It could be CCF. That's the only comment.
That's the good part, that you presented a case which has got involvement of ophthalmology, neurology, radiology, but it is more predominant of ophthalmology, what I feel. I request Dr. Anand, unmute yourself and put your comments.
Hello, good morning to all. I think that part is already discussed. I just want to know whether if the similar case presented to us right now in a recent time, are we able to manage these cases in our institute as of now?
Can I take up that question?
Yes, sir.
So that's what I was asking yesterday, the resident who came to me for discussion, that it what is there in orthopedics for this case. And like Madam Dr. Vinita Gupta said very rightly, it's more of ophthalmology and neurology things. But I think it's worth for an orthopedic surgeon also to know about these things, because they handle the polytrauma patients. So they would, if the patient comes to them and they diagnose it timely, then it will be worthwhile for the patient, because this is a very difficult condition to treat as far as IR is also concerned. The second thing what Anand was asking is that about our status. Indeed, we can now take up these cases, but this is one of those circumstances, one of those very few circumstances where we would need a biplane DSA equipment. And unfortunately, the one which we have is a uniplane equipment, because as you can very well understand, that this has got multiple complex collaterals. So each time when we inject, we have to take multiple injections, multiple times contrast media will have to be injected in the vessel of the patient. And if we have a biplane DSA, we can every time we can take two simultaneous projections. So in those cases, we can reduce the amount of contrast media dose, intravenous contrast media dose, which have to be administered to the patient. So we can do it. But then I think they were correct. And as sir said, that it was a 2016 case. So AIIMS Neuroradiology is definitely a very good department, and they are expert at managing such cases. So so that's what I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request Professor N.K. Agarwal, sir, unmute yourself and put your comments.
Thank you, Dr. Abhishek. I think this is a mostly of a cavernous sinus thrombosis rather than only fistula, because pulsatility will not be there. And this whole chemosis is because of thrombosis of the cavernous sinus. So probably other things also have to be managed. Thrombosis part has to be managed also.
Thank you, sir. I request Dr. Deepak Mishra, if intervention radiology is not available, so what option is with you? You can manage this type of patient?
Dr. Abhishek, as far as cavernous sinus thrombosis is concerned, we can manage them because the treatment is basically based on the systemic antibiotic and another thing. But when as keratoconus fistula is concerned, still without the help of radiational radiologist, we cannot manage it. Because only one we can do is we can provide us the symptomatic relief. As per Dr. Rahul sir is saying, to manage the proptosis by the crunch glasses are another thing. But unless we treat the etiology, we cannot treat the disease as such.
Okay. So if there is somebody from neurosurgery department, I request them to put their comments. Any faculty from neurosurgery department? So I request Professor Amit Rastogi, sir, a final concluding remark from your side, and then we will take the comments from Honorable Director, sir.
Right. Sir, the case highlights some very interesting things. One, that we should be cognizant of the fact that when patient has, normally in general, other than this thing, other than small lacerations around the eye and things like that, we do not see much ophthalmic trauma. But here, there was a hidden trauma, and because of less exposure, we, I think, did not manage the case initially as well as it should have been managed. Number two, of course, that as Dr. Ashish has just now said, we need to have good equipment so that we can treat all these patients here. And number three, all articular fractures would take priority very significantly, because anything, if this patient was already 2 weeks old when he came and it was difficult to reduce that, all these patients should be done as early as possible. So we should have good coordination between all the three branches so that all the three systems can be managed almost simultaneously. Thank you, sir. That is all what I wanted to say.
Thank you, sir. I request Honorable Director, sir, to give his comments.
Thank you. It's a case of polytrauma, well presented, showing the coordination between different departments as well as inter-institutional coordination. But as already pointed out, it's a 5-year-old case. So though it's a good learning, but it's always better to present latest cases. But here also, again, as I told last time, that during management, there's good coordination for presentation. Also, coordination should be there, like the presenting department should inform the other departments who are involved in the management or later to the case. Somebody must attend this meeting, like a neurosurgery person, so that we have good overview, good discussion. So it's the duty of the presenting department to inform the other involved department that somebody should be there for the discussion purposes. Otherwise, good polytrauma management, good case. And thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I think these points will be noted by the future presenters. And thank you, everyone, for joining the meeting. See you in the next meeting.
Thank you.